Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I am Professor Klaus Heine, and I'm a professor of law and economics, and also the director of the Jean Monnet Center of Excellence on Digital Governance. And I will talk to you this afternoon about the topic artificial intelligence and legal personality. What can you expect from me? I will first make you aware a little bit more in general, what are the legal problems as such with artificial intelligence, then what are the legal challenges a bit more in detail, and then I will zoom in to responsibility of AI and legal personality. So let's start with it. So here you see a first picture, and you see immediately this is about the tech giants who, like an octopus, influence our life. You see there the Wall Street, the Economic District, the White House, and people. And you can imagine this has then possibly also to do with fake news, competition law questions. What is about data protection? How about tort law? That's a little bit the same as liability law. And finally, democratic accountability. So, but I have a second picture. You may associate this octopus possibly with the US. And here I have a picture which I drew last year when I visited Shanghai at the People's High Court in China. And this is the AI, which is running the court system in Shanghai. And if you look to this different model of using AIs, then you would pose questions like, what is about democratic accountability again? What is with the rule of law? And what is about freedom of competition if a legal AI is impinging on our lives? So this is a little bit the most general setup in which I would like to position my talk today. Then, what are the challenges more in detail? As you all know, artificial intelligence and big data are disruptive technologies, and they disrupt also on the business model. Business models are changed fundamentally. Think simply about platforms, the Internet of Things, 3D printing, chatbots, which are doing contracts. But also our incumbent doctrinal law has been challenged severely. 30 years ago, one spoke still about, yeah, what is this AI law, big data? This is the same as the law of the horse. We do not need a law of the horse. We need a general civil law. So, but this has changed. And the question is again forcefully on the table. Do we need new legal rules to deal with AI and big data? And if this is the case, which rules would be necessary to achieve inclusive prosperity and growth for society? And recently, the EU also put this question again on the table with its white paper on AI and a human-centered view on that. So for sure, the EU Commission is a little bit too late, but it has a very specific point of departure with its human-centered approach. So if we ask then again, what is new here? What are the change drivers for this challenge for law? Then we are with the question about what about our production functions in our business models? This has then more technically to do with the economies of scale. Is that changed? Yeah, obviously yes. If we speak about 3D printers and platforms, what happens if innovations no longer take exclusively place at companies like Philips, as we heard in that talk before? But what happens if innovations take place at home? If CAD files are produced in your cellar, what about the software? What happens if decision making is made by robots no longer by businessmen? What is about the distinction between consume and production? If this is blurred, if you are at the same time a consumer and you are producing and then selling possibly something via eBay, some speak about then the prosumer. And finally, the sharing economy is also challenging us with new modes of using capital goods. You can share cars, flats, ships, and machinery. Going a small step further, on this slide, I have put some areas of law. The first is, which comes to mind, then what about contract law? You're making a contract and then an AI is also contracting. How is it then with a proper allocation of responsibilities? And what is then if an AI fails in a contract? Is then the AI responsible? How can we answer that? And what can be said is that the incumbent logic which we have in contract law at the moment is very likely to fail to give a good and proper answer here. Also, the category of trust, we had that also in the foregoing presentation, the category of trust played a role. Yeah, but what is trust into an AI? What is trusting into a contract you have with an AI? Then in tort law, also questions popped up. How can we control for development risks if households produce AI content? As in household and research and development department like Philips? Obviously no. In which way are then our laws and regulations incentivizing to overcome developmental risks? So also here we see or have at least a big question mark in which way the incumbent law could support solving those problems. Moreover, how can a household compensate then victims in a tort law case or in a liability case? Has a household enough funds to do that, like Philips or Albert Heijn? Question mark. Finally, property is also an important category here. In how far can get, for example, startups get access to big data and platforms and also to valorize on a business model? Here, the big question is, and you may know this also from the news, that grandfather's competition law cannot provide easy and reasonable answers. Only think about, for example, the Facebook WhatsApp case. There was a merger. Was that for the good? Big question mark. Competition law could not give a good answer. What is about Google advertisements or Google News? All those questions play around with property. Finally, tax law. Also a big challenge we have here. What is then the meaning of added value at all if value chains do no longer exist as we know it? And what happens if an AI is generating intellectual property rights, like in pharmaceuticals or software. So these are all areas of law which are challenged by AI and the big data question. So now I would like to zoom in a bit deeper, and I will do this then mostly by the help of tort law questions, but let's give it here a start. What happens to doctrinal law if machines decide autonomously? So a machine is in principle doing the same decisions under uncertainty with a learning algorithm as humans do. And the question is, can companies who are the owners of those machineries still handle those cases, or may it or occur that a company may say, we have nothing to do with this decision. We cannot compensate you, victim, because this was a decision made by the AI. We have nothing to do with it. Could happen according to the incumbent tort law systems or liability laws that we have. So the question is on the table, would it be a way out if an AI has its own or would get its own legal personality? So it would become a separate actor in a network of decision making, and responsibility could be associated to it. So, and if yes, which legal personality should be associated? So in principle, granting legal personality is not a new thing. This happened at least 200 years ago for the first time when the administration of colonies and the Industrial Revolution needed the management of complex business organizations. And at that time, there was then created the separation of ownership and control. And the separation of ownership and control took place in the invention of the limited liability company. And already at that time, people had big questions about that. For example, the member of the parliament in England, Baron Thurlow, asked, did you ever expect a corporation to have a conscience when it has no soul to be damned and no body to be kicked? So this quote seems quite modern with regard to AI. Then we had also developments with regard to enterprise liability. And in so far, the law always reacted to those societal and technical challenges. So I said that tort law has a problem with AI, and tort law is here understood as an equivalent to what we knew in Europe as liability law and accident law. And if you approach this topic, then what is the function of tort law? From an economics point of view, it is optimal deterrence. And from a legal point of view, it is the compensation of victims. And optimal deterrence means that when a decision is being taken, then the decision should equilibrate the utility of then resulting from the decision with the potential damage. So it's a cost-benefit analysis. And that is what law shall induce when humans make decisions. But here, the question pops then up, can an artificial intelligence incentivized like a human to compare utility and costs? Yeah, question mark. Is paying a compensation a threat for an AI or even imprisonment? No, these are obviously empty categories. And also at the moment, AIs have typically not their own assets and incomes to pay compensations to victims. So what we see here is, and therefore I gave you this example, that that we have to deal with big challenges in our incumbent doctrinal law. So now, what might be the solution? And I propose here taking the step over the bridge and granting legal personality to AIs to solve those kinds of problems. And the basic idea we have here is that we convert the legal status of an AI from being a property of a company into a contractual relation. Now, more technically, possibly I have some economists in the audience, making the AI a part of the nexus of contracts of an organization. But to that end, an AI must be entitled also to acquire by itself property. This is the very basic idea here. If we look at the side of deterrence, then I have not such a good news, because obviously one might try to mimic a utility function within an AI with penalty points. And as long as the AI is associated to a big company, then also the R&D problem and incentive problem might be solved in some way. But this does no longer work if an AI is part of a household or in public administration. They simply have no R&D, which could be incentivized. And so far, what we see also here is a very strong trend which overrules, so to say, these old tort law principles with so-called design regulations, with prescriptions how technical devices should be built. Compensation is easier. You see already granting a legal personality would allow an AI to have a separate estate. It could insure itself and the compensation problem could be solved better here. The extras on my slide here are also very interesting, but I cannot go too deep into it. But granting an AI legal personality would open the door that an AI can have patents, copyrights, in all kinds of intellectual property rights. It could be taxed. It could be even expropriated. It could be unbundled. The big data which are collected could be given to other companies. So this is a very interesting spot here and would help possibly to overcome grandfather's competition law. Yeah, I talked here already about giving AI a distinct legal personality. How should that look like? What could we imagine here? For sure, a legal personality of an AI would never have the same legal personality as a competent adult, say like a human. But we would have to think about legal personality by design and not nature. So an AI can never be a carrier of intrinsic ethical value. AI is granted legal personality because it is functional. It is functional as it is functional to grant legal personality to a company and then also to have a very differentiated company law, which developed over the last 200 years. So it would also take some time to have such a differentiated legal personality of AI. So, and if we would like to learn a little bit more, we could not only learn from company law how to grant legal personality, but also animal law. Very interesting, what rights and entitlements may animals have, and what could we learn there for AI? And minor law. A child may go to a vendor and buy a chocolate bar, no problems. But a child can never go to a bank and ask for a mortgage. And so far, you see also here we have different kinds of legal personalities and functionalities. The challenges for criminal law are then even bigger than that what I taught you now. But for example, stigmatizing an AI, yeah, what makes that sense? What would mean a loss of consumption possibility through punishment mean for an AI? Or sending an AI to a prison, that makes all no sense. And I think from criminal law, we have also to think deeper about that issue. So what can we learn? And with this slide, I'm coming to an end here. I tried to tell you in these 15 minutes or 20 minutes that AI and big data are disruptive also for law. That the attempt to rephrase the challenges that we face with AI and big data and to put that back into incumbent legal doctrines will very likely lead to an overstretch of the legal system. The gaps are too big, and the more AI we have, the more often we will hit the floor here. From a political perspective, we can assume that those jurisdictions will win the race for AI and big data that also push the law becoming a complementary driver for technology. That is then valorizing technology for social inclusion and economic growth by seeing all those complementarities. And the European AI strategy, which is built at the moment, is here a quite promising starting point. And that has also to do that Europe is lagging behind technologically and has, so to say, to focus on the more soft factors, and law is then one of those, and may make the championship in the embedding of AI in a human-centered landscape. Then last bullet point here, the EU Parliament already put those questions on the table in 2017. This was a very forceful report, but it was so far blocked by the member states and by strong interest groups from the advocacy to stick with the incumbent rules. But we will see how this develops in the future. And with this, I have come to an end, and I'm now very curious which questions you will put on the table for me. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much, Klaus, for your interesting presentation. I am Brian, and I will be moderating this Q&A session. We've got about 6 minutes left for questions. So we'll start right now with the first question. Looking back at the first picture that was shown, the cartoon, mm-hmm. It was very much focused on the tech influence, the influence of tech over North American institutions. The question asks, how do you see tech companies having a global impact, especially on developing nations? With a focus on developing nations.
Okay, this is an interesting question because I have never made so far the transition from the impact that this technology or these tech giants for sure have on building nations. What I would assume here is that at a certain moment, a nation state might become a little bit shallow because many things which are at the moment discussed in the legislation may be transferred to the shady back rooms of those tech giants. Being being a bit more forward-looking, I would say the antidote to that would lie in the possibilities to get access to those big data repositories that those companies have. And this asks then for new models, and we could not do this today, who is the owner of all those data? Is this these companies or is it society? I would like to leave the answer as such. But thank you very much for this very, very, very challenging question.
Well, thank you for your answer. Let me remind you that the chat is open for more questions. But for now, let's move on to our second question. Regarding your suggestions on granting legal personality to AI, as opposed to it being an organization's possession, could you tell us a bit more about how this legal change is being undertaken around the world? Which nations have made the most progress? And
yes. Yeah. I can say something about that. Mm-hmm. In my opinion, China has less problems to push forward to a modernization of those incumbent legal doctrines. That has also to do a bit that the technological imperative, which here is around, we speak about big data, big is beautiful here. The more big data are put together, the easier it will be to come up with appropriate laws that support certain business models. So but the flip side of this coin is, and then we are back to these trust questions, how do you make then sure that people can trust in those more big data fashion legal designs? So this is one part of the answer. The second part is, it might be that Europe is catching up here, because Europe has now this human-centered approach, and seeing this complementarity and embedding legal changes into a democratically accountable framework, that might be the key here. But let's see. I see less advantage for, so to say, let me say it that way, for the US model, which is stuck for a couple of reasons in its common law doctrines, which cannot be changed so easily. So this is my answer to this second one.